star shines in the sky. Below in Bethlehem, the King is sleeping. Oh, what a glorious night. Oh, what a glorious night.
Amen. Glorious Amen. Night, church. Amen.
Well, it's good to be here on this Advent morning. And this morning we light the candle of the angel. Let me read the scripture. It says, "But the angel said to them, 'Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior is born to you. He is Christ the Lord.'" Amen.
Forecast is bad, but it's nice and warm in here, and you guys are celebrating in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Greet one another in love. Tell somebody Merry Christmas this morning, and let's continue in worship as we go.
Good Advent morning, East Richland family. I'm Amy, and welcome to this week's edition of The Update. Do we have any first-time visitors? We're glad you've joined us today. We encourage you to take a minute right now and grab that yellow card in the pew rack in front of you. Fill it out, and at the end of this service, bring it to the Welcome Center in the foyer. We have a gift for you and information about our church. Friends, family, we are planning an evening of fellowship for you on the complimentary Festival of Lights Church Bus Tour on Tuesday, December 20th. Meet in the church parking lot at 6 p.m. Please sign up in the pew pad, and remember, children must be accompanied by an adult. East Richland French Church cordially invites you to our Christmas Eve program, December 22nd, 23rd, and 24th. Come early at 6 p.m. to enjoy cookies, fellowship, free family portraits, and the string quartet. Our performance of A King is Born will start at 7 p.m. If you are not able to attend, tune in to the live stream on Saturday, December 24th at 7 p.m. Just go to erfriends.com and click on Watch and Listen. On Christmas morning, we will celebrate the birth of Jesus at all three worship services. Keep in mind, there will be no Sunday morning connect groups or youth. Nursery will be provided during all three services, and the children's department in the kids zone will meet only at 9:30 a.m. to celebrate a happy birthday Jesus party for kids 2.5 to fourth grade. We look forward to celebrating this special morning with all of you. New Year's communion will be served on Sunday, January 1st during all three worship services. Join us to bring in 2017, remembering our Lord's sacrifice. From the pastors and church staff, may your Christmas be filled with light and joy and your new year blessed with hope and peace through Christ our Lord. As always, check out your bulletin for more announcements and events going on in our church. And remember, sign your name in the pew pad. We'd like to know you were here. That's all for now. Thanks for listening to this week's edition of The Update.
As I was doing some reading about the Christmas story, especially the wise men, it hit me as I was reading that these men had come a long ways, and we really don't know what their spiritual background was. We presume that it was not. They were probably just God seekers looking for truth. But the one thing that stood out to me is they came to Jesus bearing gifts. And we know, as believers in Christ, that one of the great aspects of our faith is our giving back unto the Lord and giving unto Christ. We don't just give to the church, we're giving unto the Lord. And we ought to be better at that than strangers who have never seen him before. We're going to ask April to come and share a need about scholarships for our school.
We are continuing on in the middle of seeking support for our scholarship fund. But, you know, God is so good. Just this morning, he changed what I was going to say and gave me what it was. And that's real life situation of my own family. My son drops off his two little ones at 7:30 in the morning so he can go and he and his wife lead praise and worship at his church. But he said to me, Mom, pray for me. I found out an hour ago that I need to fill in for my pastor to preach. And my heart, you know, that's what these scholarships are all about. He's a product of this church. He's a product of our Christian schools. And so whenever you are thinking about maybe supporting the mission of a scholarship fund for our Christian schools, I can testify for my children that it makes all the difference in the world to them to have that solid foundation. So thank you as you are prayerfully considering giving it to the scholarship fund.
Amen. Thank you, April. I want to add to that, too, that many times people will come to me and say, well, we really can't afford to send our kids to your school. And I say, I'll trust the Lord if you'll trust the Lord. And what I mean mean by that is you trust the Lord to bring in money to your life to help support the school. We'll trust others to help bring in that amount so that kids can come here. We don't want children not to come here because of money. We want them to come here and hear the message of Jesus Christ and learn in a Christian environment so that they can go out and do ministry as they grow older. So we're going to ask the ushers to come receive the morning tithes and offerings. Thank you.
believe that this morning, church, that he shall reign forevermore? I want you to just sing that chorus. Would you just sing it with me? He shall reign. Here we go.
He shall reign forevermore, forevermore.
Sing it out. Profess it.
He shall reign forevermore, forevermore.
Do it again. Time to come and fellowship together. God, I thank you that you will reign forevermore, and through your Son, the babe, the Christ, that you sent 2,000 years ago as a perfect sacrifice, as the example of what we live and what we are to do. God, I just pray that you will forevermore reign in our hearts, in our minds, in our spirits, as we grow and as we learn and as we celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ. May we take it as a personal, put it in our hearts that he shall reign evermore, and those that believe on the name of Jesus have everlasting life. As we pass away from this life and we move into the next, ever, ever, and ever in your presence, in your glory. Just thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. I'm going to open up this place. If you've got something on your heart this Christmas, just bring it, kneel before Jesus. As we sing, you come.
Let faith arise.
share the scripture this morning from Luke chapter 2, starting at verse 11. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests." Remain standing for prayer.
Dear Father, we humble ourselves before you, thanking you that you are a great God, worthy of all our praise. You have seen our dire condition and have made a way for us through the blood of your own Son. That's hard for us to imagine, that before the creation of the world, we were on your heart. Before the beginning of time, you determined that you would save your creation. And I pray, Father, that that truth would humble our hearts before you, that we would not only believe and receive you as our Savior, but that we would be on a pursuit in life to be more like you every day. I pray for this week's events, for all the cantatas and then the Christmas morning and the outreach at Fair Point. We pray, Father, that all of these would bring glory and honor to your name, that people would come here who have never been here before, would hear the message of Jesus, and they would accept it in their hearts. We're praying for revival, Lord. We pray for those who cannot be here today. We lift up those who have been very ill. We lift up Don Stevens. We pray, Lord, your healing touch on him. We pray for Bob Kimmler and his healing process. And we pray, Lord, for Bill Grimes and Gordon Martin as they recover from knee surgeries. We pray, Lord, you'll just heal them and strengthen them. We pray, Lord God, that you'll be with our nation. Lord, we pray for all those who serve our country in Washington, all the leadership, that they'd be humbled and turned to you. And that, Father, there'd be a revival in the government of our nation. And that you would surround these leaders with your truth. And Lord, I'm praying for a great awakening to sweep across our nation. And let it begin in this church, in our hearts, as we open ourselves to your truth and would obey it and seek to live for you. Forgive us, Father, when we get sidetracked with all the things around us. We do pray, Lord, for our valley. We pray, Lord, just return industry to us. And that, Father, we would know that it was you who has blessed us. And that we would be good stewards of what you give us. And we pray, Lord God, that today your Holy Spirit would move among your people in this church and in the churches around our community, that your word would be heard and people would respond. Pray for Pastor Dave as he brings a message. Let your anointing be upon him. And Lord, we love you, we worship you, and we praise you for this wonderful season as we remember your great sacrifice for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning. It is good to see you here today. I don't know how the roads are. I know they were talking about them getting a little bit icy a little bit later. And that brings me to a quick point of housekeeping for us as a church as far as weather emergencies and closings here at the church. I want to let you know that we will not close Sunday morning services officially. If there's a level 3 snow emergency, you have to be careful about that. But Jerry told me earlier he'll be here. I'll be here. So if you want to venture out on a level 3 snow emergency, we can sing and they can always walk here. That's right. That's right. As far as Wednesdays go, we want to let you know that anytime East Richland Christian Schools is closed for the day, we will lay down any of the Bible studies or anything that's happening on a Wednesday during the day. As far as Wednesday evening, stay tuned. We'll try to make that determination early afternoon and let you know. A lot of times we'll get a snow, and by the afternoon or evening, they've gotten the roads cleared, and we like to have Bible studies in small groups as much as we can. So I want to let you know that if you're not on our One Call Now system, if we don't have a phone number registered with the office, make sure you get that to Becky Mills at the office. We can get you on that One Call Now and make sure you're up to speed on all those closures. So we good to go? All right, very good. Well, we're approaching, in case you didn't know, Christmas is next Sunday. So the guys are freaking out. I know probably the ladies are, oh, I got this. I'm under control here. There's a few days left for shopping, but it made me think about gifts here a little bit. Have you ever picked up a gift whether it's a Christmas gift or a birthday gift, and it's wrapped up, and you know what it is. Oh, I've been waiting on this. I just know what this, and you open that thing up, and you're just so, and it's not even close to what you thought it was going to be. Have you ever had that happen to you? I don't know if you have. Or how about this? Somebody will give you a gift, and the packaging is not indicative of what's inside the gift. I saw on the internet, I was looking up some funny Christmas gift pictures, and I saw this guy sitting on a love seat with a box on his lap about this big. His brother had given him a gift card. He wrapped it in a big, huge box. I suspect some of you probably have put an extra weight maybe in a box to make it seem heavier than it was. I happen to have a son who likes to do this. He likes to take a gift and wrap it 7, 8, 9 times. I don't know if you guys know anybody like this, but that's not all. A couple of those layers are packing tape. You can't just rip packing tape, or duct tape. And he particularly likes to do that to his little sister. So I'll let you do a little scavenger hunt and figure out which of the boys does that. But, you know, if you have that happen to you and you're looking forward to opening this gift, and maybe you just don't know what it is, there's something about that anticipation, that looking forward to what is this gift going to be. The Bible tells us that God has given us a gift, and he did this very thing with this gift. It didn't come in the way that it was expected, because for centuries, the children of Israel, these are God's people, had expected, they were awaiting the special gift from God. And the Bible calls him the Messiah. And they thought he would come in a particular way. But we see in our passage today how God chose to reveal this gift to mankind. So before we dive into our passage, I think we need to set the stage. For what exactly would the children of Israel, what kind of gift were God's people expecting? And I want to share that with you today because I think that's very important. Because they had prophecy like this. Look at Isaiah 9, verses 6 and 7, where it says, "For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this." And when we read passages like this, we see the terminology in here sounds pretty majestic. It suggests this vibrant leader capable of large displays of authority and of power. How about a couple of chapters down in Isaiah, chapter 11, beginning in verse 1, "A shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse. From his roots a branch will bear fruit. The Spirit of the Lord will rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and of might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, and he will delight in the fear of the Lord. He will not judge by what he sees with his eyes or decide by what he hears with his ears, but with righteousness he will judge the needy. With justice, he will give decisions for the poor of the earth. He will strike the earth with the rod of his mouth. With the breath of his lips, he will slay the wicked. Righteousness will be his belt, and faithfulness a sash around his waist." And when the children of Israel would have read these things, and of course they all came true in the gift that was given, but not in the way that they expected, they would have expected this gift coming in pomp and circumstance, a sort of royal gift wrapping, if you will. But God chose not to do it in that way. And this is even shown by who he told about this gift. And so we want to dive into our passage in Luke chapter 2 today. If you don't have your Bibles and you'd like to follow along, you can grab a Bible in the pew. In the thicker Bibles, you'll find this on page 1014. In the thinner Bibles, you'll find this on page 716. By the way, I always mention the thicker and thinner Bibles. The thicker Bibles don't make you more spiritual. They're just a different printing. I just wanted to bring that out to you today. First of all, we see in verses 8 through 10 in Luke chapter 2 this, "And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, 'Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people.'" And first of all, we see that God chose to reveal this gift to some shepherds. This gift of the Messiah, he chose to reveal to the shepherds. And so this begs the question to me, why? Who were these guys that he would choose to do this? The shepherds were tending their flocks on any other night. They were likely not very involved in religious practices because of the job that they had would have kept them away from the temple. And there's likely nothing different about them except this. The flocks that they were attending were very likely what are called temple flocks. These are the animals that would be used in the sacrificial system in the temple. And so we want to make sure that we don't miss this very important connection here, that Jesus' birth was a necessary first step in fulfilling his purpose here on earth. And here is why. He was born that he might die as a sacrifice for you and me, to take away the sins of the world. Just as it says in John chapter 1, verse 29, it says, the next day John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And so it was completely fitting that God chose these shepherds who were tending to the very animals that represented the sacrifice that the Messiah himself was about to make. Isn't that beautiful? The way God does that. Jesus Christ would be the final sacrifice. Those animals would no longer be needed after Jesus would do the work that he was going to do. And we read this in Romans 6, verses 9 and 10, where it says, for we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, he cannot die again. Death no longer has mastery over him. The death that he died to sin once for all. But the life that he lives to God. Notice now in verses 11 and 12, they say this, today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find the baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. And we see in these verses here that the message from the angel was so much more than just a majestic birth announcement. This wasn't just a fancy way to make a birth announcement. We have all kind of creative ways to announce a birth, to announce a wedding, save the date cards and all of that. This was so much more than just a fancy birth announcement. There are two very important parts of this announcement. First of all, it says a Savior has been born. Did you know that this word Savior, they would have actually borrowed this from the Romans? See, what the Romans used to do is they would celebrate the birthdays of their emperors and their deities, and when they would have these celebrations, they would refer to them as their Savior and as their Lord. And so now the angel is giving this information to the shepherds with something that they would understand, but the word itself means deliverer. It means deliverer. The second part of this announcement is Messiah, the Lord, or as Pastor Brian read, Christ, the Lord. This was the second part of this announcement. It means anointed. Him being anointed as if his hands were laid upon and it was intentionality behind his coming. And so what we really see here is a deliverer has been born to you. He is the supreme anointed one. Did you know that this combination is found nowhere else in the New Testament? This is a special announcement, an incredible thing that was coming to these shepherds. But we need to take a step back because there's a dynamic in the two parts of this announcement that I think we need to pay attention to. Many, many people are happy to accept a deliverer, to be pulled out of whatever it is that's in their life that's going to bring peace to their life. And they love that part about the deliverer, but we can't have this message without the second part, and that is making Christ Lord of your life. Oh, well, we got to take a step back there because I have a hard time surrendering control of my life over to somebody else. I'll take his deliverance, but I don't want to give him my life. Is that true today? Is that true even in this room today? Are there those of you who look for the deliverance of God out of the circumstances of your life, but you have never taken the step to surrender your life to him and to be able to call him Lord, to make him the master of your life? That's hard for us to do. But there's another dynamic in these verses, and it's simply the word today. The angel said, today this has happened. You see, they weren't visiting a toddler that was 2 or 3 years old. This baby had been born today. Notice the words that are used in these verses. Born, baby, lying in a manger. These are describing a person that was born. And I got to thinking, how could they have really grasped the scope of this message? Because he's talking about a deliverer being born in a baby form. But just in case, the angel gave them a way to prove the authenticity of the message. He said, go and find him. And what I want to talk to you about now is, imagine what they would have found. If the angel said, today a baby had been born to you, it's very likely that when they found Mary and Joseph and the baby, they would have found a mother who had just given birth. I was thinking back to when my kids were born. The anticipation of them coming out, the 9 months and Rachel was carrying them, and what are they going to look like, and all this kind of stuff. When I was born, my dad couldn't come into the room. And a lot of you were like that. My dad wasn't allowed in the room, but I was allowed in for the birth of all three of my kids, and I bawled my eyes out when all of them came out. It was an amazing, amazing thing, but you know what? They were all beat up. Their heads were like footballs. And they've returned to good shape for the most part. They were kind of gooey when they came out. They had to be cleaned up. Why would we think that the shepherds would have found anything different when they went to see the baby Jesus? A mother who is recovering from the labor and delivery process. A baby who is recovering from the labor and delivery process. We don't know if Joseph fainted. A lot of husbands do that. Probably didn't. He might have been the one that delivered the baby. This would have been a family who had just gone through the birthing process. And I'm here to tell you this morning that we need to peel away all of those visions that we have of the baby Jesus lying in a manger with his arms stretched out and a halo around his head. You've gotten that Christmas card before, haven't you? They would have found this flesh and blood baby. And I got to thinking about that. And then I remembered that John chapter 1 verse 14 said this: the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. And we can't miss this truth this morning, because this is a most amazing truth. The God of the universe became flesh. The God of the universe became flesh. And I asked the question to myself, how could he do that? It's hard for me to grasp the fact that when Jesus came, he was still fully God, but he was fully man. And what does that look like? We read about what he did in Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 8, where Paul writes this: in your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Very God came down and clothed himself with skin and flesh so that he might be able to accomplish the work that he came here to do. And on top of that, in the process of joining this nature of God with the nature of man, we read in Philippians 2 what's called the kenosis passage. These verses that I just read to you, where he voluntarily laid aside his position in order to put on the flesh of a man. And you see, as we've been talking about what the shepherds would have found when they came across this young family, two teenagers having a baby, that was God himself robed in flesh. And he had to do that. But you see, Jesus had all the elements of true humanity: body, flesh, bones, blood, hands and feet. The Bible even tells us that he had to learn. Look at this verse in Luke chapter 2, verse 52. And Jesus, what is that next word? Grew in wisdom and in stature and in favor with God and man. Jesus grew. I'm going to read for you a couple of thoughts from a book called Beautiful Outlaw, written by John Eldridge, commenting on this humanity of Jesus. It boggles the mind the eternal Son of God, light of light, very God of very God, one substance with the Father, spent 9 months developing in Mary's uterus. Jesus passed through her birth canal. He had to learn to walk. The Word of God had to learn to talk. He who calls the stars by name had to learn the names of everything, just as you did. This is a cup. Can you say cup? Or did you think baby Jesus came into the world with the vocabulary of dictionary.com? For ages upon ages, his generous hand fed every creature on earth. Now it is he that has to be fed, spoon-fed, drooling most of it down his chin like any other toddler. The Son of God doesn't even know how to tie his own shoes. Someone had to teach him how to tie those sandals. John the Baptist said none of us were worthy to untie. Picture 7-year-old Jesus in the shop out back, learning from Joseph how to use a hammer and saw. He who hung galaxies in such perfect poise, like 100 billion mobiles, has to be shown how to nail 2 boards together. And as I read that, I reflect on it. And I think that he didn't have to come and do that for me, but he did. Put himself in this flesh casing so that he could experience everything that I experience. And that he could be the perfect sacrifice that I could not be, that I might have an eternity with him in heaven. That's what Jesus did. Prophetic passages like I read to you earlier in Isaiah meant that the Jewish people were looking for a sign. And I wonder how many times, how many of you in this room have asked God to just give me a sign. I want to take the right direction in my life. But the sign involved with this baby was only minutes or maybe hours old. And here's my challenge to you this morning. Maybe you're sitting here this morning and you're saying, man, I've been looking for a sign, for something that makes life make sense. I've been looking for a way out. And I'm here to tell you that the message of the passage this morning is that the sign is here for you, and it is Jesus, God in the flesh. He came to make sense of your life. He came to offer you a way out, a way out of the despair and helplessness that you might be feeling today. He did not come to offer you a fat bank account or perfect health for the rest of your life, but he did come and offer you something. For those of you who have chaos in your life and you have questions in your life and you are riddled with guilt, this little baby came that he might bring hope to you. That's why the Messiah came. Notice how many times in the verses that we've already read that it says, this will be a sign to you. This one is coming to you. This wasn't just for the spiritually elite. This is for everyone. And as we move on in our passage this morning, we realize that the angels got it. They understood the significance of this message. Let's look at verses 13 and 14. Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests. We see that all of heaven rejoiced at this message, this revelation, this uncovering of the Messiah. And the Bible tells us it was a great company that came out. Now, there are some Bible scholars who believe that the angel that gave the message was Gabriel. But it wasn't long after he gave the message that the rest of the angels said, oh, we're going to get in on some of this. And it says a great company. Folks, this was not 10 or 100 angels that came out. The terminology for a great company here is actually a military term used to describe an army encampment. This was a lot of angels that came out, just like the ones that are talked about in Revelation 5:11. Then I looked and heard the voice of many angels, numbering thousands upon thousands and 10,000 times 10,000. They encircled the throne and the living creatures and the elders. In Hebrews 1:6, and again, when God brings his firstborn into the world, he says, let all God's angels worship him. As a matter of fact, Kent Hughes, commentator, says this, I think every one of God's angels was there because this was the most amazing event that had ever happened in the entire universe. I think the heavenly host stretched from horizon to horizon, obscuring the winter constellations. If you think that those shepherds were a little bit scared when an angel appeared, imagine the sky being filled with angels because they knew that this announcement was going to change everything. And how many times have you heard this message and it changes nothing? They were glorifying and praising God. That was the only response that was natural at the announcement of the ages. The root word for praise here actually means story. You see, the angels, all of the angels, wanted to be a part of this story of the revelation of the Messiah. And their proclamation was of God's glory and peace on earth. And the word for peace here, it actually means to join. And so what we see demonstrated here in the peace that they were talking about this Messiah bringing is that he was going to accomplish by coming to provide an opportunity for man to be reconciled, to be joined once again to his Creator, to have peace with God. Not a life without distractions, not a life without trouble, but to know that they know that they know when this life is over that they will be able to spend eternity in heaven with the one who created them. That was the message and the work that this Messiah was coming to bring. Some commentators speculate that the angels actually sang these praises to the Lord. We don't get that from the text here. But I got to thinking about that. However they were proclaiming it, Psalm 96:1 says this, we are to sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord all the earth. Psalm 98:1 says this, sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm have worked salvation for him. We come here and sing. But are we singing out of hearts that have been made new? Out of hearts that have been refreshed? Out of hearts that grasp the gravity of the Creator of the universe, putting flesh on that he might die on the cross, that we can have freedom in eternity forever and ever and ever? Well, we must move on. Verses 15 and 16 say this, when the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about. So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. And we see in these verses that the shepherds set off with urgency to find the gift. I can't imagine that that was not after a moment with their mouths wide open after seeing the skies filled with angels praising the Lord. And they headed off with urgency. Now, I know some of you probably do this. Something we've been doing a little bit more recently on our Christmases is we've been doing little scavenger hunts in the house. Just something fun to do. And you kind of gain this anticipation of what the end of the scavenger hunt is going to reveal. And I got to thinking about that with these shepherds, because here's what would have had to have happened. Because Jesus was not born at a building with an address, they would have had to have gone into Bethlehem and began checking in these caves and stables to see which one the baby was born. And the angel just said, you'll find him laying in a manger. So they set out on a scavenger hunt. But the text tells us that they hurried off. They did it with a sense of urgency. And can you imagine what their conversation was while they were looking? Can you believe what we just saw? Do you think there's a baby going to really be here laying in a food trough? When is the last time you have had a sense of expectancy or urgency about Jesus? Is this just another holiday? Oh, here we go with winter again. I got to get my shopping list done. Boy, those Christmas carols sure are getting old. Where is the sense of expectancy in the church today? This Messiah that has come to do the work of salvation, to rejoin us to the one who created us, says that I have not promised you tomorrow. You must know me today. And I think we've lost that. And I want to encourage you to consider Jesus this year with fresh eyes. Those of you who know him and have a relationship with him, look into his face and see the love that he has for you. This baby, clothed in flesh. We move on to verses 17 and 18. We see this. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. And now we see that eyewitnesses attest to the truth of the Messiah. The shepherds, as Scripture says here, had seen him. And that word for seen or to see him, it actually means that they stared at him. Can you imagine when that scavenger hunt was over and they finally came upon this young family and they saw this baby staring at him? It's true. Have you ever been one of these people? I don't believe it unless I see it. Oh, you got to go to the Grand Canyon. It's beautiful. The expanse is incredible. The rock formations. Well, I don't believe it until I see it. I had an opportunity in high school to go over to Europe, and I got a chance to go to the Louvre and see with my own eyes the actual Mona Lisa. I guess I had thought it existed before, but it was right there in front of me. I saw it with my own eyes, and that's a painting by a human being. Imagine what the shepherds would have thought when they saw him. The proof that they found impacted them so much that they couldn't keep it to themselves. They had to go out and tell somebody. Did you realize this? That the shepherds were the first eyewitnesses to the gospel of Jesus Christ. They were the first ones who had seen him that shared the gospel news with other people. He is born. And the message that they shared was so amazing that the people around them were in awe of what they had heard. They marveled at the news. And in verses 19 to 20, we see this. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. And we see that the revealed Messiah causes deep personal response. Is that how it was for you when you accepted this free gift of eternal life? Did it cause a deep personal response in you? A lot of times we refer to this as coming to a crisis of faith, that moment when you recognize that there is nothing that I can do to affect my eternity in a good way, and I must give my life to Jesus. Did it move you in a deep and meaningful way? We get a pulse, a little glimpse, just briefly, into mom. And it says that this new mother, Mary, was taking it all in. It says she treasured these things in her heart. And what this term means is that she kept them together, close to her, and she guarded them. As she was observing and witnessing and being a part of what was going on, she kept all of these things close. Not one thing was lost on her. And then it says that she pondered them. And so it means that she took these things and she placed them together for comparison. And she began to think over them, over and over and over. She had a deep personal response to what was going on. And as far as the shepherds go, not only was their wonderment expressed in that they were telling everybody, but the passage tells us that they were also glorifying and praising God for this gift as it had been revealed to them. The angel didn't lie. He was there. And they were praising and glorifying God because of what they had seen. And so the answer to the question, why of all people did God reveal the Messiah to a bunch of dirty shepherds out in the field? Because he was demonstrating that this message is for everyone. There is not a single person that you have ever met in your life that you know now or that you will ever meet in your life for whom this message is not for them. This message is for everyone. You see, if he had revealed this information to the spiritual leaders, perhaps they would have kept it to themselves, thinking, oh yeah, this is the one we've been looking for. But no, this message is for everyone. It doesn't matter what your background is, what your life looks like today, this message is for you. This message of hope and peace. I think they were the best ones to reveal the Messiah to, because they were open enough to receive the message and they were curious enough to go check it out. Consider what these shepherds would have gone through. The sending of this gift, everything that we've discovered in this passage today, all comes down to this. It's the fact that God loved us so much, he would send a baby. There's a dynamic, I guess it would be in physics, where if you have two pianos that are properly tuned, perfectly tuned in the same room, and you strike a note on one piano, the chords for that same note on the other piano will begin gently vibrating. It's called sympathetic resonance. And that demonstrates a wonderful dynamic with the Savior of the world. You see, God said, I love you, my creation, but because of your sin, I can't have anything to do with you. But I will accept a perfect human sacrifice to pay for your sin. And so he sent Jesus, who was already perfect and lived a perfect life. But he had to become a human in order for it to be applicable to you and to me. And not only that, in his humanity, Hebrews chapter 4:15 tells us this, and I'm going to read this from the New American Standard. It says, for we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has been tempted in all things as we are, yet without sin. And so you see, by Jesus coming in the flesh, he is able to have sympathetic resonance with you and me. And so if you are sitting here this morning and you have a challenge in your life and you think there is nobody that can possibly understand, I am telling you, there is at least one who does. And his name is Jesus. Because when a chord is struck in your heart or in your life, or in mine, Jesus feels the same thing. And if you have been looking for that one, the one that has the answers to all of the questions in your life, the message that was revealed to the shepherds is the same message for you today. He is the Messiah, Jesus Christ the Lord. Let's stand. I'm going to ask you this morning to just have your heads bowed and your eyes closed before we go to the Lord in prayer. Statistically, this time of year is the hardest for people who suffer from depression, anxiety, discouragement. And if we're going to be honest with ourselves, that means there are people in here who are struggling with depression, anxiety, and discouragement. I don't know everything that's going on in each of your lives, but I don't have to challenge you to let this be the day that you surrender all of that to the only one who can take it from you, the only one who can sympathize with those challenges in your life, for he felt them himself. If you're here this morning and you need to leave something at the altar, I want to encourage you to take this time, just quietly step out and do that. Every head bowed, every eye closed. If there is something that you've been carrying around and you want to leave it here, I love to tell people, you leave it here and we'll sweep it up later. Jesus wants to take that from you. And if you're here this morning and you say, I have not come to that crisis of faith, but I think maybe I am now, to recognize that I need a Savior, that I don't know where I'm going when I die, let this be the day. We're going to celebrate Jesus' birthday next week. Let this be your spiritual birthday today, where you surrender your life to Him. If you want to come down, Pastor Brian, Pastor Jerry and I, we would love to talk to you and pray with you. Father, as we stand here with our heads bowed, so many people in here today, many may need to get honest with themselves and honest with you and let go of difficulties and struggles that they've been holding on to. Father, and there are some here today, there have to be, who have never genuinely made you the Lord of their life. Father, may this be the day that they do that. We want to tell you, thank you. Thank you, thank you for the gift of your Son. Thank you for the way that He came. And thank you that you revealed Him to these shepherds who spread that message so faithfully. Father, we want to tell you that we love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Angels, we have heard on high, sweetly singing all the plains, and the mountains in reply echo back their joyous strains. Gloria in excelsis.
Don't recognize Him for who He really is. You see, He didn't stay a baby. He grew up and He accomplished everything that He said He would do, everything that His Father had set out for Him to do. And if He hadn't done that, there would be no reason for us to be here today. So as you celebrate Christmas, let these things be on your heart and on your mind. And as followers of Him, we should emulate the shepherds, and may it be on our lips to everyone we come into contact with. Father, we love you. We thank you for tasking us with sharing this message of truth and hope to this world, for everyone. May we be fully functional followers of you, spreading the gospel, living in a way that would bring you honor and glory and would reflect what you've done here in our lives. We pray for all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen.